Hi everyone, welcome to today's session as part of the Cambridge Live experience about keeping energy levels up with while teaching remotely. My name is Pablo Toledo and I work for Cambridge Assessment English as Assessment Services Manager for Southern Cone and Andes. Presenting this session, we have Rosalia Valero and Jonny Frank. Rosalia Valero is Strategic Development Head Americas at Cambridge Assessment English. She's based in Mexico. Two of the main beliefs that she lives by professionally are that once a teacher, always a teacher, and that the best teachers never stop learning. Jonny Frank has worked in English language teaching and education for more than 10 years in a variety of areas, teaching, materials writing, assessment, marketing, and recognition. He's now based in Mexico City and works for Michigan Language Assessment, a joint venture between Cambridge Assessment English and the University of Michigan. Like most of you, we are working from home, but we are aiming to give you the best experience we can. We are relying on home Wi-Fi, so please bear with us if we have any issues. Before we start, here are a few suggestions to help you get the most out of today's session. We recommend headphones to get better quality audio and to hear better. Try not to have anything else running on your computer, especially things like Skype. Switch off any other programs if you can. Don't worry if the picture is a bit blurry at first, that is the live streaming and it should hopefully improve. During the webinar, you will need to be able to use the chat box on the right of the screen. Please use the chat box if you want to type any comments. Please use the Q&A box for any questions to our presenters. If it is something that we can answer straight away, we will type an answer for you and we will keep some questions for the Q&A session at the end. So don't worry if your question is not answered straight away. We might ask you to use the chat box or polls for some activities during these sessions. So without further ado, let's get started. Rosalia, Jonny, the floor is yours.
Thank you very much, Pablo.
Oh, lovely introduction.
And hello to everyone. Hola to all our friends and colleagues from Latin America.
Have you been counting the countries, Rosalia?
I've been looking at the names. Absolutely amazing. And some lovely, lovely names. So thank you all, colleagues.
I was writing them as they logged on. There are quite a lot.
I know. So we're here again, Jonny. How about we start? Because we have
absolutely
lots of things
yeah.
to share with our colleagues today.
I've got the power over the presentation, haven't I, today? Isn't that something? But it's great. One of the reasons that I said about how many countries are here, and thank you to those that are joining us from time zones that are very very much now nighttime or early morning. I guess that's like a little microcosm of the breadth and the variety and the challenges that we're facing. And part of the purpose of these days is to be able to offer a range of sessions, varying from cooking to tips to more kind of concepts. And this should help, hopefully, there should be something for everybody, essentially, because it's a very wide audience we're dealing with here, isn't it, Rosalia? And teaching is different, even in the same city. Teaching has numerous different teaching
in the same
contexts,
country, so. The same city, yes. And the amazing thing, and I think it's absolutely brilliant, is that we'll be able to watch all the sessions, even if we cannot make it, because we've had some very early sessions here from Mexico. So some things starting at 3 o'clock in the morning here. So it's good that you have all the links so that you can watch things on Facebook, YouTube, etc.
And speaking of videos and whatnot, I think we better get on with this. I'm going to steal your phrase here, Rosalia. I'm
going
to say going not like a Mexican train or something, because we have half an hour. I've watched some of these already, and I know that the timing is crucial. So let the title of our presentation.
You have learned well, young Padawan. That's what I always say. We have to go like a train, but not a Mexican train. So let's start. We're saying today we'll be talking about keeping energy levels up when teaching remotely, right? And this is very important. And you will see, we will be talking about you, our colleagues, ourselves. We'll also be talking about learners and also about our learners' parents, right? So without further ado, as Pablo said, let's start. Okay.
This was your inspiration, wasn't it, Rosalia?
Exactly.
So can you explain what you mean by the essence of wisdom and how that's going to affect the session?
Okay, well, I hope it doesn't affect it so much as this is what I started, this is what got me thinking about maximizing energy levels and making sure that the energy is still there, right? And as you know, Jonny, I believe in mindfulness. So I have mindfulness sessions every day, right? And every day it's a different thing that you get to reflect on, etc. And I liked it when I saw this one from S.N. Gonka. This has to do with Vipassana meditation, and he talks about the essence of wisdom, and he says that we can look at wisdom from three different perspectives. And this is when you start hearing about something or reading about something, you start getting borrowed wisdom, wisdom from others, right? What you write or what you hear, what you listen to. But then when you start analyzing things, when you start evaluating things, saying why and how and where, et cetera, you start to develop your intellectual wisdom. And then finally, when you start doing things, when you are reasoning about the things that you're doing, when this is really becoming something that is yours, that's when you develop experiential wisdom. And I think this has to do a lot with what we have been seeing regarding remote education, don't you think?
Yes, and I think it's how we can be a collective in terms of supporting. Rosie and I have both been teachers, and I'm going to adopt your mantra of saying once a teacher, always a teacher, obviously. We're always thinking about how things impact the classroom, how things impact learners and teachers. And I like this because it basically covers how, as organizations, whether it's from an assessment perspective, a teaching perspective, a publishing perspective, a learning perspective, they're all encapsulated within these kind of pillars of wisdom. And that's why I said it affected the presentation. Maybe it was a bad choice of words. We'll say it's going to inform the presentation.
Better, exactly, because yeah? As I say today, lots of borrowed wisdom. I mean, we hope you get not everything maybe, but at least one or two things that you would like to know more about, to start exploring, etc. So let's start.
Exactly. Get those notepads out and just one or two things. And this was one thing I wanted to do very briefly, was around the world in maybe not so many days, but 2 minutes. So we know that there's a challenge that all teachers and learners are facing, and parents, and we wanted to just acknowledge or give examples of some of the things that have caught our eyes in the news or from local stories we've heard. In Europe,
exactly,
for instance.
Jonny. And yep. If you let me start, you know, you've heard me call teachers our colleagues heroes, right? Because they have been making it possible for education to go on in spite of so many different things. So I can tell you, for example, here in Mexico, we've heard about parents going to schools because their children are at home, and they go to school when they go to work because some of them have had to continue working, right? And teachers have left notes outside the school so parents can go and take notes of what their children should be doing or how they are progressing. I think that's absolutely fantastic. And then you have, for example, cases like Peru, where this is more like high tech, where public schools are now, the students are now getting tablets so that they can really do things online with the teachers, etc.
Yes.
Oh, and just remember, sorry, I wanted to tell you, pickup trucks in Mexico, amazing. And these are not and also something very interesting. These are female teachers, right? So they have been using their pickup trucks to have very small groups with learners, with their face masks, etc., where they go, because these are learners that have no access to internet, for example. So they go and make sure that they take notes, everything, etc. So they meet like, they can only have 4 students in their pickup truck, right? And then 30 minutes later, another group of 4 students, et cetera, et cetera. Amazing. Heroes, really.
Absolutely. And we've seen other examples, like I think in South Africa, the ministries published a lot of free readers or books that parents and teachers and learners can use, which personally I found amazing. I read some of them. Beautiful illustrations and stories, very rich culturally also. In China, there's been a big thing about social media, helping teachers out with support communities there. We've seen teachers doing songs about being clean and keeping distance in India, which is really cute to see, like a teacher doing, you know, clap the hands and got a rhythm to it. And in Europe, similar to one of the examples you said in Mexico, that, you know, hanging or leaving work for pickups in places like supermarkets, because people were limited to how many exits or how many trips they could do per day. So I think we went for 2 minutes, 1 second there. So we're going to buzz on. And really, this exposes that, you know, when this first started, there was lots of talk, not just in education, but across the board, saying, oh, this, what an equalizer this is. Everybody's in the same position. And then very soon afterwards, people are like, well, actually, they're not in the same position. There's a big difference in terms of available resources, available bandwidth, number of computers, infrastructure of internet in certain countries or regions. And so we like these two images, don't we, Rosalie? Because they tell us something about what we're living through.
Things that are still happening. I mean, and you can see these even at country level or even at state level. It's not the same in a capital city than when you go outside the capital city. So where we go, and it's not just very simply saying this is happening in private education, this is happening in public education. There are differences, right? And this has made it very clear that we can see these the differences, and that there is really a digital divide. People who can access technology. I also told you, for example, some hotel managers, very resourceful people who really want to help their communities, who say, okay, schools are closed, hotels are closed, nobody's coming, but I still have to pay for electricity, for cleaning the rooms, et cetera, whatever. And they have turned their hotels into practical classrooms, Jonny, right?
Because they know. Yeah, that was a case in Oaxaca, wasn't it? Yeah.
Exactly, nice. Right? So that they have the people who live there, their community, they cannot have internet, all of them. So they're making it possible, right? So this is a serious thing. And we know it's something that is happening, the digital divide. But there are different things that can be done. And that's why whenever you and I talk about the digital teacher and working remotely, etc., we talk about high tech, but also low tech, because that is really very important. Or sometimes no tech at all.
Absolutely. So this is going to be like our starting point in a way to say, well, we're starting to discuss a little bit about what we've learned so far and what can help us. Some people are going to be starting new school terms or have already started as we speak. Some of them in a little bit more time, or they're going to continue remote learning. So we have an amazing amount of countries. We have many different contexts. So we're going to try and bridge some of those and join some of those dots up. It isn't going to be, hopefully it will be partially life-changing, but not totally, I don't think. So we've learned that we've got many challenges. And what we're going to explore here is what can we learn for the future? And what are some of the things that can help us be more effective in the classroom, whether that's virtual or otherwise, when we return to giving class?
Right, and Jonny, and just to say, one of the things we really want to stress is that technology gives you a great opportunity to think about teacher talking time. How could we reduce that?
That's going to be a big theme. Yeah, a big theme in the next 20 or so minutes is just us being a bit quieter as teachers. Unfortunately for you, not Rosalie and I today, we're going to be speaking at you for the next 20 minutes, but that's the format. But we will be able to hopefully give some tips and some ideas on how we can engage learners.
Jonny and I really enjoy talking. So when we started talking, thinking about what we were going to be talking about today, we say, well, Jonny, if you think about it, it's like there's four P's, right? Because there's a platform you have to use. There's the planning that you have to do. There's the people that are involved, and there's progress and how you check it, et cetera, et cetera. That's how we started planning these like a couple of months ago, Jonny, when we said these are the messages that we want to say. But then these developed.
Yeah, we thought that it was a bit too slightly general. So we came up with, we turned P's into T's.
Because we wish we'd
had
a,
I wish we'd have had a TP here to really present that. But anyway, that was a late thought that we couldn't put it into the presentation.
Yeah, people can imagine all the sort of things that we had talking about the difference between P's and T's, etc. Right? But let's not go there. So we said, instead of talking about the platform, let's talk about technology in general, right? When it comes to planning, we're really talking about teaching, the delivery of teaching, of lessons, etc. And when it's people, it's say, let's look at the teams that are involved in this. And if it's progress, we're really talking about testing, right? Assessing, or even simpler things, probably like tracking how things are going, progress, how the technology is really working, etc., whether you're making the most of technology or you're becoming a slave, because sometimes that can happen and we should avoid that at all costs.
Absolutely. So as Rosalie said, there are enhancements we can make to the learning experience. We we see it, and we know that there's a lot of stress on teachers. We're hoping that the beginning of the new school years has allowed for some of the initial changes to settle in, and for you to have certain techniques and tricks you can use, and that you would be on the same page as us in saying, let's go for a can-do attitude. What can we do with technology? It can really open up creativity, even students. And in fact, even with low or no tech, it gets us thinking about exercises in different ways and different planning techniques and different teaching.
Exactly, because you and I have talked to hundreds and hundreds of teachers in Mexico and other countries. And one of the things, for example, we see happening is they say, okay, online is not really a possibility for 100% of my learners, right? But things like WhatsApp, we can make that happen, right? So yeah. We see that lots of teachers are using WhatsApp. They're actually calling not just the learners, but in the cases where they have young learners, very young learners, etc. We're talking about kindergarten, primary, or lower school learners. They're talking to their parents, and this is something terribly, uh-huh, terribly important. So it's time to embrace new possibilities, Jonny.
It is. And we're going to be very brief on technology because we've seen lots of information, not just this week, but others on it. We just thought we'd add some subcategories to technology as a category. And that's really to try and make it as light as possible. It's quite likely that your institution already has the technology it's going to use. There's not much you can do about that. So it's a case of doing what you can with it. And we would always encourage you to use what you have. And then if you're going to bring in something else, make sure it doesn't affect your planning so that you're doing far too much of it and you're not confusing students. So keep it simple, use what you have, be ecological with your resource, and also be willing to change and adapt. I saw George and, George and Sarah yesterday, and they were explaining quite nicely how sometimes you have to basically change and adapt things. Sometimes you can probably keep it the same and just give it a different edge. Oh, something happened there. Sorry.
Something happened there. But we started talking about being ecological, and this has to do with keeping our energy levels up, because there's so much that you see you have to adapt or change because now you're doing things remotely. And that's what we talk about being digitally ecological, because we have to talk about reducing the time we spend preparing everything. We really need to look at how we reuse activities that we have created before, not just for the remote or virtual classroom, Jonny, but also about things that we used to do in normal classrooms, and how we can recycle activities, maybe leveling up or leveling down. Right? Yeah. What you said about the platform, that is a fact of life. Whatever platform your institution has chosen to use, probably you don't have a say in that. So embrace what you have and let's learn how you can make the most of it, right? And then adapt. Absolutely. What you already know what to do and what's already worked in the classroom.
And speaking of adapt, we've got, this was something that, adapt activity. So especially with young and teen learners, it's all, when I was teaching, it was always good to get them to burn some energy off either beginning of the lesson, in the middle, even at the end, as you're coming to the end of the class, just if you want them to concentrate on a final activity, get them to burn some energy off before they do it, so you avoid restlessness. So one of these we've borrowed from actually an activity we did within a chat group we have of colleagues. Do you want to just explain the scavenger hunt concept?
Very quickly, yeah. This is something where we said, remember we talk about maximizing energy levels, and that has to do a lot with you, the educators, the people who are teaching there, right? Trying, making learning happen, right? So scavenger hunt, there is a list of things and you have to go and get them, right? How can you do this? You're not outside. You're not in a car going different places. You are at home and your learners are at home, right? So, and even remember also teacher talking time, trying to reduce that. Get your learners to create their own scavenger hunts, and they're going to think about their homes, right? What they can find. So it's going to be things like maybe a mobile, things like a blue pen, right? Maybe things like a book, etc., etc. So it can be something that they can plan for the following day, and then they can challenge different teams, right? Have them do that at a team level, for example.
Or take them by surprise and just do it at the beginning of class. I want you to find me something that's blue. Yeah, it could be very simple, just colors, for example. They run off and they come back and it's all exciting. And oh my God, I'm doing something that's not looking at a screen. I'm actually, so, and like Rosalie said, you could get them to plan their own so they start to direct it. You could even start to teach or to introduce the language of judges to be like, oh, I'm not sure if that gets 2 points because although it's blue, it's a hat, not a cap. This maybe not language like that. And they might say, but instead of although. But you know, you could start to really develop that into a student autonomous activity that they go in, prepare, and they come in, they do as a class or maybe even in groups. It's exciting. Right. It gets the blood flowing. It gets the adrenaline up. And when we did this, when we were the students, and a big shout out to Mauricio, a colleague of ours here in Mexico, yes, who introduced us to this.
Well done, Mauricio.
I loved it. Absolutely loved it. So this can really work quite nicely. And that's
okay. Yeah, so adapting. This is where I start challenging you with time, Jonny. Yep. So let's go because we have lots of things to say. So
including this. Yep.
Yep. But you have to make things your own. You have to adapt what you hear, as you say, going from borrowed wisdom to intellectual wisdom so that it can become your experiential wisdom. And one of the lovely things we can do is because we now have this opportunity, Jonny, which is also a challenge, and we will see these in our when we show our next slide, is that technology shouldn't mm-hmm. be your enemy. We should really embrace it, make the most of it, and see how we can use it, for example, for interaction that maybe wasn't possible before when we were in brick and mortar classrooms, right? So we have different things. So teacher talking time, again, I just want to tell you an anecdote very quickly. I heard from a friend whose children are doing remote learning, right? And then suddenly my friend realized that her son was not really doing a lot of things, but actually playing a lot, right? And she said, what happened? And then her son said, the teacher fell asleep about 20 minutes ago and we don't want her to wake up. So we're just pretending to do things, right? This was a teacher who was so tired, right? Or sometimes, which is even a more regular case, and beware because this can happen. And believe me, when I tell you, young learners will not let you know that you're still on mute. Right? So you think you're doing wonderful things. You think that the great teaching is happening and they are just doing something else because they cannot hear you, right? So careful with technology. And always, as we said, make the most of teacher talking time. And we're going to show when giving instructions, Jonny, remember I told you some time ago that I realized, and this is absolutely fascinating, we teachers are so used to asking questions. We usually ask questions and our students have to answer questions. And sometimes we don't realize that we don't give them the chance to ask the questions. This mm-hmm. is something that you can make happen in the virtual classroom now. Get them to ask the questions.
Yeah, and you can deliver instructions in a different way, actually. I mean, I you know, you could draw the activity coming up. So they start guessing it's a speech bubble. Ah, it's a speaking activity. And then maybe you draw like a sun and a beach. Ah, about my holidays. You could even do it with mimes, which to be honest, I wouldn't like to do in front of a class, but I would probably do it over a screen because I would feel a bit less conscious about it. And there's not other teachers peeking in and taking a look and thinking, what's Jonny doing there? So you can from delivering instructions, you can reduce teacher talking time and increase their focus and engagement because they're not just saying, oh yeah, all I need to do is listen. No, they need to engage. And then maybe as Rosalie said afterwards, you're going to get them to ask each other questions. Say, I don't know. Lisandro, ask Pablo what this activity is about. And Pablo's been paying attention and he's like, oh, it's a speaking activity and I'm going to talk about holidays. So you can really throw some dynamism into how you're delivering classes. And that's so it doesn't, you don't have to feel like it's you
we love,
preaching to
Jonny.
A crowd, right? Yeah.
Right. I mean, especially if you have, for example, you're teaching higher education. This is something great. As I said, whatever platform you have to use, learn to love it. It may not be possible to love it. Jonny and I have been invited and to do different webinars using different platforms. There are some we really like. There is one I really hate. I won't mention any names now, right? But this is something we started seeing in Teams, for example, because we use Teams as an organization, right? And it's the fact that everybody who's in the chat, you can see them like that. And that is absolutely amazing. And then I really like it when we're talking about teacher talking time because it really forces you to reflect how many of them are there and there's only one of me, and who's talking most of the time, right? And now there's no reason to say they cannot do these. And just going back to make sure that they have something to talk about, pets, for example, are usually very common. So something that you can do online that you that it wasn't possible to do in the classroom before, maybe in some cases, but I would say very few cases, is that, okay, tomorrow you're going to have a few minutes to talk about your pet, and you can have your pet there. Right? Yeah. So isn't that a great idea? Things that you can do
and tell,
you will make sure. Yeah.
Show and tell without the hysteria of a school bus or a car journey to school. And also what we were trying to say here is, as Rosalie said, that such a, 30, 40 people possibly, hopefully fewer, but most classes are quite big, aren't they, online? They're probably, they want to listen to you sometimes, but then they're probably quite keen to listen to each other. So bear that in mind.
We're going to be talking about parents, but just bear in mind, we were showing you young adults there. Bear in mind, when it comes to young learners and very young learners, you really have to talk to parents about certain things like these, for example. Yeah. And you have to make sure that they're okay with that and they know what will be happening, okay? And this is something that I know you enjoy, Jonny, because as I say, we usually give a few recipes, and this time, wow, you have sort of different things here. So rock away, Jonny.
Yeah, I do like my boring tables, but we're not going to go through every single one. So the idea here is when you're planning and teaching, it's basically just planned for that variety of interaction, and also scaffolding, which a lot of you'll be common with, but trying to create activities that build up and don't just jump in at the deep end, and extending activities for those that finish quite early. So for variety, I love things like revealing words or pictures slowly, if I can do that on the board, maybe by rubbing out something like a color I've put over it, or flashing a word on the screen, so they quickly have to guess and tell me, what word they saw. Some work better with images. Some students are really kind of good with images, some are good with words, and that helps to add variety. You're not saying anything, you're just like, maybe what's this, is the activity, it's a, or is it a. So prediction's always quite nice, guessing's nice. TPR, total physical response, is again something you'd feel a bit less conscious of. I love doing it as a teacher when I was teaching primary, but there are some teachers that were like, nah, that's not for me, because they're a bit more reserved. But maybe in the comfort of your own home, you're a bit more prepared to be going jogging or going fishing and having the students guess. Again, reducing teacher talking time and increasing student interaction. And then for scaffolding, just a couple of ideas here that you could, realia, like actual objects, are much easier. Now they're at home, you can show objects or get them to show, like Rosalia said about show and tell. You can also have drills. You could still do drills, whether they're individual, class, choral, group drills. Do it, again, it gets them saying more, and students love drills. Teachers tend to not like drills. I love drills, like the sound of my own voice. No, I don't like the sound of my own voice, but they like it. They like practicing pronunciation. Don't be afraid to do those. And again, for weaker students, before they do a speaking activity, if you've drilled some of the phrases they're going to be using, they're going to feel a lot more comfortable, and therefore they're going to actually enjoy and do the activity well. And for extending, early finishers, right at the bottom there, have your early finisher activities ready. And it's, you could have links or vocabulary games you can just throw as a, okay.
Breakout rooms. Hazel's finished. Rooms are a great way. Yes.
Hazel, go and do this activity. And that's much quicker than in a classroom where have I got a photocopier or something or whatever. And what else were you saying about, I spoke over you there.
No, it's okay. That breakout rooms are great, because you can send them to breakout rooms where you have different activities for the early finishers, as you say. And it doesn't have to be, because I remember years and years ago when I was a learner myself, right? Say, I don't want to be the one who finishes first, because then I have to do more work, right? And as you say, it doesn't have to be more work. It can be a fun activity, right? And absolutely, you can have those ready.
I like the idea about giving them some choice and saying, we've got four breakout rooms or five, and we're going to have class secretaries. That's something that I really focus on here, having class representatives that are recording new vocabulary or leading activities, and it's a rotating position, and maybe even reporting to parents what you did that week or that fortnight. So giving them some responsibilities and some autonomy, and that will be motivating for most of them. And if not, it's something they're going to have, it's a skill they're going to have to develop at some stage, that learner autonomy, so they need it. Obviously, this is more for reference. We've breezed through a few examples, but the fundamental points are: keep it interactive, keep it varied, reduce your speaking. Be prepared to scaffold from a very, very low level sometimes, just from basically pictures and saying what they can see before you get into, for speaking or a writing activity. And then be prepared to extend and have some very self-explanatory quizzes or activities ready for early finishes. Or I love your idea, Rosalia, of having those breakout rooms to say, oh, go and do something about, I don't know, write and improve, for example, going to that room and
different things. And some people have been asking us, some colleagues, whether they can find breakout rooms, and they mentioned different classrooms platforms. This is something you have to explore, please, because I mean, we haven't become experts. We have survived different platforms, Jonny and I, right? But make sure you just go to the help section in your platform and you write breakout rooms and see what they say about it. But we're coming to a very important topic. Well, I think all the topics are important, all the different things we're talking about. But this is when we start talking about people and we're talking about the team. Because now, in most cases, your learners are still at home, right? Mm-hmm. So they are at home, but they're not on their own, especially if we're talking about young learners. They are there and chances are they are with their brothers, their sisters and parents, right? And we have to make sure that they all know. We should really keep them informed and they should know what is happening and what is expected of them and how they can support and help.
And I remember actually when I was teaching at school in Madrid years ago, there was a poster on the wall that said 30 years ago, and it had the teacher sitting at a desk, the students sitting opposite and the parents shouting at the students. And then it said, now, teacher at the desk, student at the desk, and the parents shouting at the teacher. And I think there'd be a different cartoon, surely, whereby we can bring the parents in a bit more effectively, because we're all going through kind of unsure times and they want to know that their children are still benefiting from a consistent delivery of education. So they'll be happy and motivated to join you for some of the ideas we've got coming up.
Exactly. I mean, and when it comes to parents' journey, we've had all sorts of anecdotes lately. We have like mothers who are looking at what their son or daughter is doing, etc. But there are also other mothers who are there, and when the teacher asks a question, you hear the voice from the mother first giving the answer to the kids, right?
Didn't go. Yeah, I mean, so there is a high degree of enthusiasm with certain parents engaging them, bringing them in. We've got some ideas coming up, and we're also going to touch on food and drink.
It really is very important. You have seen Jonny and me here. We've got our water, but this is something, and really we're talking about young learners again. You really need to engage with parents and you really need to say, okay, this is the teaching will be happening because we want learning to happen, but we really need your support because they're your kids and they're at home and you can help a lot and you can really make a huge difference, right? So very important. We encourage you to have a conversation with parents as soon as possible when you start classes again so that they know, and lots of different things that they can do. And I think people are going to enjoy the next subject.
I do, and you've got a couple of monitors there. I just have my laptop here. So you're going to be handy here, Rosalia, because we've, you know, throwing a bit of variety in, why not use phonetic script to introduce concepts, keywords, or activities?
Exactly.
Well.
So the first thing we want everybody to do is to
what does that say?
Say that. What is that saying? Exactly.
What are they saying in the chat, Rosalia? You tell me when it comes through.
Okay. People who want the link, don't worry, we will share this, right? But what do you think that is about, right? It is a word in English.
Absolutely.
New rubrics. No, I know. We are sending people.
Close. Done.
But there's
close.
New.
Not in terms of concept, but.
One, two, new rubrics. Somebody said it. Yes, thank you.
Awesome.
Right? Thank you. Yes, new rubrics. What is aerobics, Jonny? Remember the first time I told you, and I know I have to say to everyone, I love working with Jonny and co-presenting because usually when I tell him, I think we should include this, right? Thank you. And you say, okay, what is that? Or what has that got to do with teaching, right? And this is where I come and say, okay, neurobics, we're talking about gym for our brains. And I think this is absolutely fantastic. And this is one thing that you can do that will really help you maximize not just your learners' energy level, but yours as well, which is great. Absolutely. And it's something that if you explain to parents, you will see that they will probably like the idea and they will see why things are happening. And but sometimes it seems as though their sons and daughters, their kids are doing things that are a bit strange or uncommon, unusual, right? So we started talking about different things. And here, of course, Jonny is my lovely volunteer who was volunteered by me.
Guinea pig.
Exactly. I call you lovely volunteer, Jonny, because that is so much more positive, right? But strategies
and
different sorts of exercises, right? So, for example, I use my right hand to write, okay? Sometimes I can use, and this is what I'm going to ask Jonny to show us now. So, which is your dominant hand, Jonny?
Right.
Okay, now use your left hand and write your name. And show us.
I'm going to go for Jonny rather than Jonathan, which is my full name. That's sort of cheating, but Jonny.
Go for Frank. yesterday you changed your name to Frank.
It's not a bad effort. It's not a bad effort, look.
Okay, you know. Well done, right?
Room for improvement, but quite good.
Okay. Think about what's happening when you're doing this. I've already mentioned mindfulness, and there is at least one session I know on mindfulness. So please go there if do it because it really is helpful. And there are lots of things to do with mindfulness. And for any of these activities, I just want you to know you don't spend 30 minutes doing these. You don't even spend 10 minutes or 5 minutes. These are sometimes things that you can do in a minute or under a minute. And they will bring something different. It will be a nice breaker from whatever it is in the activity. And it will relax your brain. What happens when you relax your brain, Jonny? You're maximizing your energy level, right?
Yeah.
So mindfulness, breathing. And one of the most important things to remember here, please, non-invasive. That is the most important word to remember about neurobics. Brain fitness, but it must be non-invasive, right? Yes.
Two things I like here are the Mozart effect. It doesn't even have to be classical music, but introducing music, which I used to like doing anyway in the classroom. You could have a certain song that you play, or with your phone to the microphone, that triggers some sort of response. It could be that they have to go grab some water, or they have to run quickly on the spot for 30 seconds or whatever. Again, a break. It breaks up the class a little bit. And I also like the idea of, I love the idea of writing instead of typing, but I also like the whole reading very slowly and quickly, just to add a bit of fun into instruction delivery, if you're going to choose to do that verbally rather than in writing. And we're speeding along here, Rosalia. I think this was where we were saying about the importance of mindfulness in terms of journals as well. We have other sessions that we've been
working. Reflection, Jonny. Reflection.
Yes.
We have to reflect. It's not just doing. We are trying new things, or we are remembering things that maybe we used to say, I wonder whether I can do these this way now, because I don't have them here, but I have technology and they can do this, right? So how can I make it work now? So reflection. And I know you, Jonny, so you enjoy your tea, and you use tea when you're reflecting and writing your diary, right? Your journal.
Well, in fact, I know people that have started a diary. This was less, well, to do with work and personal, but they started a journal when this happened, which I thought was just very interesting. It hadn't occurred to me. It was actually Sarah, who we know in Idesa in Guadalajara, who was saying she started a journal, and I was like, that's phenomenal. That's a really nice idea. But I also think parents could be involved in this in terms of a journal, and definitely student diaries. That would be a great way of getting them to reflect. And not as an exercise on language accuracy, definitely not. I've done student diaries before, and that's so important every time they're putting something in the journal. And to keep it light, you could just have three bullet points of how they're feeling. In fact, Brad did a very nice session yesterday with Ricardo where they were looking at takeaways after the week. And I think they had something like, what did they find difficult? What did they overcome? And how can they plan better for next week? Which is all about a growth mentality. And I think that'd be a fantastic way of engaging students
to reflect. And digital ecology.
Yes,
totally. Because it will make you reflect on what you can do again, because it really worked.
And just to sort of move us on, there might have been questions about certificates. So there's a link there where you can download it. It's going to be available somewhere. I don't know, but there will be certificates for this session. Continuing neurobics and me being your wonderful, lovely volunteer, Rosalia.
Please, Jonny, tongue twisters, right? Tongue twisters. And I said to you, Jonny, if you want, I can do something in Mexican Spanish, right?
Yes.
Something like El parangaricutiri mi cuero se quiere desparangaricutiri mi curizar, but probably doesn't make sense to many people here today. So let's do something in English, Jonny. So,
well, again, this could be something just to break up the lesson and the dynamic, or even to end with vocabulary items in a weird order. But yeah, Peter Piper's a famous one. So the P, if you want to really go for the P sound. So Peter Piper picked a peck of pickled peppers. Peter Piper picked a peck of pickled peppers, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. Now,
et cetera. I shouldn't be et cetera.
But you would probably have what would be a great idea there is to have a countdown. So, Rosalia, if we have time, you could put a 30-second countdown there. Jonny, go on. Peter Piper pickled a peck of pickled peppers. Peter Piper pickled a pepper. And it just changes your focus onto something very narrow.
But he didn't pickle.
A bit of fun.
He didn't pickle.
Oh, he pickled.
He peaked.
Peter Piper picked a peck of pickled peppers. But anyway, there are lots of these available, and you can identify the ones that for your learners' first languages would be the most prescient. For example, red lorry, yellow lorry, where you've got an R. Don't, Rosalia, hold it together. So, red lorry, yellow lorry. Red lorry, red.
And you know what happens when people try to do it? When you try to be the example to your learners, that you laugh, and laughter is the best medicine. There's nothing wrong with laughing. And if your students, your learners, see that you're laughing at yourself because you cannot go red lorry, yellow lorry, red lorry, yellow lorry. That was
trying to go too fast.
Saying, red lorry, yellow lorry, red lorry, yellow lorry, red lorry, yellow lorry, red lorry, yellow lorry, etc. Showing off, indeed, right?
But yeah, you really select ones that were relevant to your...
Let me have a little bit of water while we go to the next one.
Red lorry, yellow lorry, red lorry, yellow lorry. There we go.
Jonny, I wish I had a tongue twister for this, but it is my sorry task to remind you that we have 5 minutes to go.
Perfect. Of course. Thank you.
That's why we're talking about water and why it is so important to have water. Please, when it comes to water and your learners, make sure when you talk to parents to say and do emphasize it's a water bottle, not a glass. Horrible things can happen with glasses full of water and technology, right? So let's go on.
We have time, I think, now. This is good. This is interesting. The final T, can remember what it was? Can you remember what it was, the final T that we mentioned at the beginning to do with
tracking.
Progress? Tracking, yeah. So we don't want to have a laptop like this full of post-it notes and paper and confusing our minds. At the same time, this is quite an ambitious way of looking at it. possibly over-tracking.
No, so there's different ways of tracking, right?
Yeah.
And the most important thing about tracking is you have to remember, you don't want to be repeating everything exactly the same way you have been doing. You want to know what has been working and what hasn't, etc. And being aware of the fact that we've only got about 3 minutes, Jonny. Let's go and see when we talk about tracking. We said this is like, remember, it's not really that it's a race, but it's are tracking.
What we don't want,
team.
Basically, we don't want students to look like this in front of their laptops. And that's why having some tracking, even as light as it is, some reflection, something if you can feed back to maybe those WhatsApp groups you've got with parents, or maybe those twice monthly meetings you've got with parents, that you're able to report back and say, we've done this and we did some assessment and we're seeing progress. Otherwise, students will just be there like this, like, oh yes, teacher. And that's why we're saying reduce teacher talking time, plan to teach, but in an interactive and dynamic way. And the technology can allow us to do this, and be prepared to track and to keep assessing their progress in English. So we don't want this. It's not, neither is it a race. Each of us has our own race, but this involves learners, teachers, and parents. And that's why when I spoke about that picture earlier on, bringing parents into the digital room is much easier than bringing them into the physical kind of face-to-face classroom.
And why am I showing you celery now, Jonny?
Because we've got a wonderful image next coming up, but we think that snacks also are important. That could be part of the parent meeting, right, Rosalia?
Exactly. As you can see, because we're going to go, this is like, as I told you before, non-Mexican train to make sure you see everything here. In the next slide, you will see some things that you can suggest to parents, right? healthy snacks. Okay. Yeah. So think about, I have here, for example, celery, right? Mm-hmm. Think about carrots, broccoli, etc., things and things like that. And let's go to the next one. We're going to ask an intriguing question, Jonny, and is why did we include this light? It's not just to remind us of time, because we've only got a couple of minutes before Pablo comes back with all those great questions, but it's also because we thought then when we started planning that there's also one thing we have to be very careful about that we really have to consider, and that is
time. The only thing that we can't kind of do anything with, but time, to not over plan and over prepare the teaching, and also to give yourself time. This is, you know, and ask parents, say, you know, give us time. We're getting there. There are going to be bumps along the way for everybody, but, you know, we're a team and we're going to make the teaching work.
Exactly. Yeah, so in
time
the next
our
20
final
seconds.
Cheeky.
Exactly.
And finally, we basically said, to reemphasize what was said in the introduction, never stop learning. Activities like this are great to come and pick up one or two ideas per webinar. It's not going to be something that can just dictate how your teaching is going to be. That's for you to do and your learners and your colleagues. But what we hope to have done in this presentation, Rosalia, is basically...
talk about, be very proud of the results you're getting. I mean, some people have asked us, but I cannot get my learners to pay attention to me for 50 minutes when I'm teaching online. Okay, let's be realistic here. They were not paying attention to you when you had them face to face for 50 minutes, right? Yeah. First of all. So we have to be, careful. We have to be realistic. There's always lots of things that we can do. Think about being digitally ecological so that you can reuse, reduce time, do things that you can do again, recycle activities that you used to do before or for different levels, et cetera, et cetera. Share with your colleagues. This is really a team thing. It's really team effort on so many things.
And before Pablo comes in, just a final word to say, we like to think that the journey we've gone on, which is very quick in half an hour, has gone through those wisdoms that we came to at the beginning and that we're finally
exactly.
ending
we
on.
Exactly, we didn't have time for you to boom, snap and clap, Jonny. You were going to boom, snap and clap
boom, snap,
because we
clap.
Got this great idea from our colleague, Dr. Connie Reyes, when we saw her at the conference last year in Querétaro, right?
Yes, but that could be within the neurobics where you just have a break and get them to do things and boom, snap, clap is the boom, snap, clap to the right or maybe to the left or twice to the left or once on each. Go slow, speed it up. But anyway, so many ideas, so little time. We are now open, I think, for questions, Pablo. Handing back over to you.
Thank you. And thank you, guys. And apologies for interrupting you earlier. Though we have a lot of questions. Rosalia, your references to mindfulness have been very well received by many.
Yay!
I would like to start, I think maybe a good place to start would be, we have a question here. What happens if we get our students so overexcited that then it becomes difficult to get them back into the learning mood? Is that a concern? How would you deal with that?
Well, I would say, what do you usually do in the classroom? Because yes, there are certain things you cannot do here. If you get so excited that they start running, first of all, I have to tell you, for example, this is why it's so important to talk to parents, explain to them, there will be some physical activity, but if you see that physical activity has been going on for 5, 10 or 20 minutes, something is not really going well and probably what is going on has nothing to do with what I'm trying to do with them. Right? That's why it's so important to see parents, because you're not there, they are, right? So, and they were the ones going to tell you, for example, my desk is very near the staircase, right? So I cannot do lots of physical things because I'm very near the staircase and I don't want to have a fall. So it happens, it always happens. Just think, just because we're doing things remotely, that doesn't mean that teenagers have changed, that doesn't, and they will stop challenging you. That doesn't mean that young learners will still lose their attention span, because they're young learners, right? So be prepared and don't be discouraged. You can try things in a different way. You can sort of let a couple of days, 3 days go on, and then you try it again.
I would also encourage. plan for variety, so have high intensity and low intensity within the same class. So it's not all hyperactivity. There's time for them to maybe with some smooth music on, they're doing an individual exercise after they've been doing some TPR. So don't plan for it to be this kind of helter-skelter, crazy 50, 60 minutes. It's a whole concept of warmers and coolers is here as well. You want people to be right. to be excited, but then also to bring them down. So in some of the slides there, they've got ideas on how to bring it down as well. Even if it's just, like we had that one, what was the idea you had for mindfulness in the classroom, Rosalia, where it was picking up a pen and saying, this is a pen.
The 1, 2, 3, you choose 3 things. Yeah. So I say camera, and you're just breathing, remember, non-invasive, right? And stress ball, right? I don't know about you, but this is something I usually have here, right? So so it can be, and remember, I mean, colleagues who teach young learners, this is where you say, okay, this is like the 30 seconds where you go quiet. This is quiet time, right?
Okay.
So I'm afraid this is all the time we have for today. There are other questions, but we'll leave them there. And there has been a lot of very rich interaction in the chat box, so many of them have been talked with the audience. So thank you very much, Rosalia and Jonny, for a great session. Thank you for everybody for tuning in, and we look forward to seeing you again in the rest of the Cambridge Live experience. We still have lots of great things to go.
Yes, see you. Including a fantastic session from you and Alberto Pablo, so we'll be tuning in for
tomorrow. Yes,
yep. Absolutely. Look forward to seeing you all there.
Yeah.
Long live and prosper. Bye.
Take care.
Goodbye, everybody.